As they say in Cloverfield, people are going to want to know how this happened.
How Congo, the movie, happened.
How did... The question we'll be answering on this episode of the Culture Cast is, how did they make Congo and why?
I've got some answers for that.
Yeah, my God. Hey, I picked this movie, though.
You did. Also, I've already apparently was starting to take a little bit of heat on Twitter promoting this recording because some guy was like, I like Congo. And I was like, cool story. Somebody else on the show.
I like Congo, too. One random guy on the internet.
Well, I told him to listen. I'm like, listen, when it comes out, one of the guys likes it. You'll just have to find out.
Maybe we both like it.
I fucking doubt that.
Yeah, you're correct.
I really fucking doubt that.
As Father Malone pulls up his shirt to reveal a tattoo of Amy with her robot
Amy,
sleeve.
Green drop drink, green drop drink, green drop drink. On this episode of the Culture Cast, we're going to be diving into Michael Crichton's classic that came out before Jurassic Park and was adapted after Jurassic Park's adaptation came out. The one and only Congo. We're here to talk about Congo, I think.
The secret ingredient is cocaine.
No, there is no incorrect. There's no cocaine involved in this movie at all.
It might have been more fun in some respects if it had had some cocaine injected into it. So yeah, on this episode of the Culture Cast, I'm joined by my good friends Mondo Heather's Heather Drain.
Hello, and thank you for correcting me on the cocaine joke, Father Malone.
I take my cocaine very seriously.
And all the way from Dark Destinations, Destinations Unknown, Father Malone.
Hey, everybody. Monkeys. Monkeys and stuff, right? And lasers. Oh, boy.
Laser monkeys.
Laser monkeys.
Yeah. So, yeah, on this episode, we're going to be watching a movie that I picked. And it's a movie that I really enjoy. So, yeah, we'll just get that out of the way right now. Like Heather said, someone on this podcast does like this movie. And it's the person who picked the movie. Woo-woo. So, yeah, let's talk about 1995's Congo.
The remote.
In the race for the world's most advanced communications technology, a shocking discovery has been made.
What was that?
Lock your remote and give me a thermal reading result to 66.
It will take two young scientists into the heart of the African jungle. Where a secret hidden for 2,000 years holds the key to the future.
This is Karen Ross, 81452 Houston, do you read?
You used to work for the CIA, and now you're travel corps.
Some will come to it for science.
This is a big deal, Charles. This is a big find.
Some for fortune.
A diamond mine of incredible bounty.
And some to return home.
She doesn't really belong anywhere, does she?
No, she belongs here.
Together, they will search.
My boss, he thought I wasn't gonna make it. He sent another expedition.
Drawn deep into a mystery.
Camp destroyed. People dead. A gray gorilla.
No such thing as a gray gorilla.
I saw one.
And the more they discover...
Same hieroglyphics over and over.
The greater the danger.
What do they say?
We are... watching you.
Help me! Help me! Ah!
Never saw any animal move like that.
Shoot it! Shoot it! How intelligent are they?
See, they're smart. They're too damn smart.
Watch out!
Go! We're getting out of here.
What about them?
Put them on the endangered species list.
From the best-selling novel by the author of Jurassic Park.
The myth of the killer ape is true.
Congo, where you are the endangered species.
So the film is directed by Frank Marshall, based off a screenplay by John Patrick Shanley, and it is based on the book Congo by Michael Crichton, you know, the guy who wrote Jurassic Park. So it's got to be good.
Got to be good.
It's got to be. It definitely can't be. Right.
That guy is a genius.
I mean, you've seen Westworld.
I love Westworld.
I love Westworld, too. And the TV show.
Yeah. Yeah. But that movie's a great movie.
Yeah,
I think it stands up to this day. I mean, I know that the effects are goofy and shit, but like, it's a great flick.
Oh, I even liked Looker.
Looker's good. I liked Looker. Yeah.
It's a good thriller.
Great train robbery. I like Michael Crichton. ER, he created, like,
yeah, boy.
Good show.
Like, talk about printing fucking money.
No doubt. And like a guy who sometimes his plot isn't great. The story he's telling isn't fantastic, but he always comes up with some fascinating concept to hang everything on. So
the way Richard described it to me, Richard Haddam, friend of the show, he described it as Michael Crichton writes books about science that's going to happen 5 years from now. The stuff that'll be on Time magazine 5 years from now.
Certainly.
And yeah, I think that's like a pretty astute way of putting it. But I'm curious, Heather, what's your take on Mr. Crichton?
Well, I got to be honest, I've never actually read any of his novels. So I do not have an opinion on him as a writer, out of fairness. The movies I've seen of his as a whole, like whether he's directed them or, you know, the movies based on his material, I've liked as a whole, save for one. And it's the one.
You see Sphere?
Yeah, I was about to say, Sphere?
There's a lot of...
Because Sphere makes this a movie a masterpiece.
I'm sure it does. There's a number of adaptations I haven't seen.
Is that the one? Is Huey Lewis a pilot in that movie?
I don't.
Because in this movie, it's got Jimmy Buffett, baby. Yeah. It's 5 o'clock somewhere, and it's in Congo where it's 5 o'clock today.
Yeah.
Holy shit, what was up with that? Just like Jimmy Buffett. And then not only Jimmy Buffett as a cameo, you get to hear his voice. Ladies and gentlemen, we're on a one-way flight to Margaritaville. It's like, why is he? Must have been friends with Crichton, I guess.
Crichton had nothing to do with this movie.
I know.
Clearly a buddy of Frank Marshall, though. Like, he seems, Frank Marshall seems like he's
a finhead, right? Yeah. He's a finhead.
There is actually statistical proof that when people hear Jimmy Buffett's voice, they crave coconut shrimp.
I like Jimmy Buffett. I'm sorry.
I'm not saying it's a bad thing.
Pencil-thin mustache.
As most things, Chris, we're reacting to the fan base and not
that's fair,
right?
I've been to a Jimmy Buffett concert. It was a bunch of drunk adults.
It's like going to a Dead show, right?
It's their thing.
That's what they do. Like, they're all kind of annoying as fuck, but like, you know.
It's like a Dead show, but with more Cialis.
Yeah. Yeah. And a lot more Hawaiian shirts, which is a problem because I like Hawaiian shirts.
I know. They're ruining them.
I know. You assholes with your love of the islands and coconut shrimp. Coconut shrimp is good, though. That's the problem.
I'm not knocking it. I'm just saying.
You know what else is good? I can't
have it anymore.
also that. But could you have sesame cake?
I could not have sesame cake either, but I really want it. It looked delicious came out of Tim Curry's mouth, I mean.
Then it looked even better.
Yeah, right. That I was willing to eat.
Open your mouth like a baby bird and let him feed you.
But only if he's doing the laugh like Pennywise while he's doing it.
Jesus Christ. I think my uterus just shriveled up.
Yeah, see, what the listeners can't see is Chris actually doing that.
It is amazing.
It's true.
Not as good as your Stone Cold, though.
Oh, sorry. I wish the monkey had, like, that's the thing. Like, so the book and the movie are similar, but they're both about
a simian.
So the book is about a group of scientists who go to the Congo, and they're followed by these assholes from this company who are looking for blue diamonds, which are going to be the future of tech. Mind you, the original book's written in 80. So they had to update it a little bit, but they did a poor job of that in a lot of ways. But the plot is essentially the same. But in the movie, they did something different. The monkey talks in both of them. There's the primate handler who brings the primate with him, who speaks English through sign language, who knows where the lost city of Zinj is, where the blue diamonds are. This is just sounding stupider as shit. The longer I describe
it. Keep going, dude.
It gets better and better, actually.
But in the movie, they give the monkey a talking gauntlet. I don't know how else to describe it. It's like a Nintendo Power Glove that talks.
Like an Erector set, though. It's even weirder. Like, it looks painful.
Yeah. And man, it's... So in the book, you know, you have the Peter Elliott character who's the handler, and he's translating, you know, there's a scene where it's, you know, with Laura Linney, and the monkey's like, ugly, ugly woman. And in the book, he's like, I'm sorry. In the book, he translates it. He's like, she doesn't like women. And in the movie, it's like, ugly gorillas, ugly. And it's like, what the f-? It's super strange, right?
Can we call her Amy the incel gorilla?
Amy, she's a shitter gorilla.
She's a shitter.
That's what you said. Like, shitter kids. Like, she's a shitter gorilla.
what I specifically said in a text is she, anybody who's familiar or fans of the Gamera series will know what I mean when I say a Kenny.
Yeah.
Like the a Kenny is the most annoying child in the movie, and Amy, and I hate this. I love talking animals. Chris and I, you and I talked, you were like, talking gorillas are awesome. And I'd say, you know, normally I would completely agree, but the problem is like, she's got this annoying robot voice and she's like, and there's this whole weird ongoing joke about, oh, they act like a married couple. And it's like, yeah, it's hilarious. Since anyway, he's having sex with this animal. I don't know. It's just like, I didn't like it. I didn't like her.
I'm not sure that was the implication necessarily.
I mean, wasn't that the implication?
They're bickering and, you know, like,
I was under the assumption it was down.
Yeah,
but I thought it was, they were fucking.
Yeah.
Well, see, they're bicker.
They bicker, but the makeup sex is amazing.
Yeah.
Okay. Peter, I guess I didn't take that thought.
Peter, sex. Peter, give me white drop drink.
Yeah. Wait till you hear her version of Kia's My Neck, My Back.
My neck, my back, my gorilla pussy. Okay, Father Malone. So give us your take on this movie. Give us your take on Congo.
When I was watching it, all I kept... Okay, this is the first time I've seen the movie. I think I'd seen the opening sequence when the movie came out, and that was just me ducking into a theater from another theater that
I'm lost.
Viewing.
What am I doing here?
Yeah. No, not at all. Like, you know, me going like, is this any good? And I watched and I was like, oh, Bruce Campbell died. Fuck this. And then I left. So
valid response.
Yeah, absolutely, man. So this is my first time seeing it. But while I was watching it, I kept thinking if this movie had been made in like 1978 and all of the idiotic things that happen in it and all the sort of dunderheaded stuff and the lame special effects and everything and like good character actors, which this movie is rife with, like if that had been the case, then I would go, yeah, you know, it's pretty good for 1978. The fact that it came out after Jurassic Park, this movie is just like, I can fathom it. It's really bad. Lots of great performances, like I said. Couple of good action scenes. No, I take that back. There are no good action scenes. And
there aren't action scenes in this movie's not an action.
No, not at all.
It's the book's not like, and what's strange is the book is the same way. Like, it's a very, in a lot of ways, it's a faithful adaptation of the book because Michael Crichton doesn't really know how to write action. Shocking, I know.
No. Well, what's funny is, so then I went after I watched the movie and read about it. And, you know, the book came out around that time that I'm talking about, because when Crichton was making the great train robbery with Sean Connery, those two became really friendly. And he thought, hey, let me do like what I did with Westworld, which is like take the old West and throw some technology into it. And I'll do it like an old Alan Quartermain story, yeah, like a
King
big
Solomon's
jungle
Mines.
Adventure. Right. I'll make King Solomon's Mines. Sean Connery's already on board. We're going to go make this adventure thing with whatever. And then they, you know, they found out that you can't train an ape.
Well, and there was also a writer in Sean Connery's contract that he was allowed to slap the ape as many times as he wanted. And they said, true. Mr. Connery, you can't do that.
Well, that's what precluded them hiring the ape, which is what Crichton's only criteria for making the movie was. So Crichton's like, there's no way they can fake this ape. I'm not making the movie. Like, it has to be a real ape or nothing. And guess what? He was right.
Go ahead.
That ape is terrible. I'm sorry. I'll stop.
No. Don't stop. Don't stop. Keep telling me about the monkey. Tell me more about the monkey.
Look, man, like, obviously they put a lot of time and effort into that fucking Amy ape, and it is, it's terrible. It's frighteningly bad. Like, this is 1995. Seriously, this is effectively the lead character in your movie. Like,
not effectively, it is
the lead character in the movie, right? And so it's Stan Winston going like, hey, I finally get to do my ape movie. Like, Rick Baker's been cornering the market forever. Like, there's a reason. Mm-hmm. Rick Baker does these things really fucking flawlessly, and this ape, our lead star, is bad. And the funny thing is, it's a character that is absolutely inessential to the rest of the story. Really, this is a story about this tech company going down and having to fight giant, like, gray killer apes, right? Like, who cares if they're bringing
but
this
ape
back?
She knew where they were.
Oh my God, don't even get me started. Like, okay.
Oh no, I completely agree with you.
Practical elements of this thing. Is this ape is a psychic ape on top of all the
yes!
other things we're supposed to deal with?
Psychic fake apes with talking with hands.
Somebody pick up the baton here. I'm tired of trying to understand the horror of this movie.
That's one of the reasons why she's such a Kenny, because like that's the thing, Kenny in the gamer movies is not only mega annoying, but somehow it has almost like a supernatural sense of what's going to happen or how any of this kaiju shit works, where you're like, how does this kid know that? It's ridiculous.
At least it isn't a little old man dressed up as a little boy and we're supposed to buy it.
Actually, that would be terrifying but amazing. It's kind of like Clifford but with giant turtles, which I'm down with. Now this movie, you know, the sad thing is the ape is terrible, a lot of the writing is not good, but I think the two things that could have made this like a cult classic is if the two leads had been different actors, because think about it, everything else when it's not with them is actually pretty watchable. Like, cause you have character actors out. It's like a buffet, a veritable Whitman sampler. You've got, Stuart Pankin's in
right?
it for 2 minutes.
I forgot Stuart Pankin, friend of the show, Commander Plank from fucking Xenon, just like, Talking Monkey will make us millions. And it's like, where's his character? Give me that spinoff. Congo 2, only Stuart Pankin. And they as a monkey.
James Karen for 2 minutes. Like, Karen. Yeah. Amazing. Yeah,
Heather, to your point, you're absolutely right. It's like they stacked every other role in this movie with a phenomenally talented and or magnetic human being. And they went, you know what? We really need to put magnetic sinkholes for our leads. Like
John Hawks is in this movie for one scene.
There's so many good actors.
Cowboy himself.
Involved in this movie. And then they give us Laura Linney. Look, she's fine in some romantic comedies and stuff. And I actually find her deeply unappealing. And Dylan Baker is a... is a suckhole of a personality.
Don't say Dylan Baker. It's Dylan Walsh.
Dylan Walsh. Sorry, Dylan Baker's great. I apologize.
Dylan Baker
is a fantastic.
He would have he would have.
What about Dylan McDermott?
Also would have been better in this role. Anyone would have been better in this role. Literally take any actor and from any of the other roles and plug them into the lead and we would have gotten a better performance.
Well, yeah, the sad thing is according to IMDb, Bruce Campbell auditioned for the Dylan Walsh role.
Should have gotten it.
He should have gotten it. Like that would
I think Frank Marshall thought he was being clever and like casting against type. Like we'll get the matinee idol looking guy and kill him in the first reel and then give us the nerd, you know? But like, though, if it's not Jeff Goldblum, you fail.
Yeah. Or, sorry, I just pictured Eddie Deason.
He would have been better.
agreed.
So much more charisma.
Yeah, I mean, it's, they literally, and I mean, I liked Laura Linney in the Tales from the, why am I blanking?
Tales of the City?
Thank you. Yeah, the Armistead Maupon, like based on those books for PBS, and she was good in that, but yeah, she is deeply, she's horribly miscast. Dylan Walsh, I remember seeing him on Nip Tuck. And I was like, oh, he's the boring one. Even on Nip Tuck, I was like, I like
the other brother. He kind of is the boring one on Nip Tuck.
I was like, I like the other brother. He's real sleazy and fascinating. But
guess what? I actually want, I like this movie. I can look past its flaws, but the things that I cannot look past are the casting of the leads. Because you know what? Every time I watch the movie, I like it less and less because I remember how much the leads are in it. And Laura, like I'm with you 100%, Father Malone. Laura Linney for me is an actress. I don't watch the things that she's in on purpose. I just don't watch them to begin with. I'm not going out of my way to avoid them. I'm just not watching them anyways. She seems to me like a very boring actress. It's like if Holly Hunter had no charisma, you get Laura Linney.
She's very waspish. She's very like, I can, she's like, she's good at playing like a patrician type upper middle class kind of staid, like uptight character.
She's
perfect
in the Truman Show.
Right.
She's probably good in Ozarks, right? That's like the one thing none of us have seen her in, but she was like well received for that. I've heard it's amazing. But maybe it suits her actorly skills better than this does. You needed to be a fun actor to be in this movie.
Well, and the thing too is like there are certain actors that I think can be okay in smaller doses, but you don't want them as the leads. Like Rob Schneider is one of those. You definitely don't want him as the lead in anything, but no offense to any Deuce Bigelow fans out there, but
they're coming for you. They're banging on your door right now.
There are any?
all two of them. But yeah.
And they both happen. One is Rob Schneider and the other is Rob Schneider in a fat suit. So
no, there are three because Adam Sandler's there too.
All right.
Hey, Cash.
But
yeah, he's the only one employing that asshole.
Oh god. But it's also like their characters, her and the Dylan Walsh characters aren't even that likable either, which again could be dealt with if you had somebody charismatic that could, but neither one of them. I mean, they're about as charismatic as Gwyneth Paltrow's asshole. Like, they're just not.
I mean, the thing is, like, again, like, that's the other thing. Like, I read the book like less than a month ago. So that was the other thing. I was like, I want to watch the movie because I read the book. Book's a breezy read, but the book is boring.
Yeah.
Because the leads aren't interesting in the book either. The book doesn't make them interesting. It's not like the book has like all these like really exciting, you know, roguish leads. It's like, no, this one guy is a scientist who's a boring dick. And then you have the corporate woman who's just who's like not a character at all, like kind of obnoxious, but about as blandly written as Laura Linney's performance ends up being.
Right, exactly. And that is so the character in the book, she's just sort of a company girl. She's not like a woman, pardon me. And she's not like ex-CIA and shit. Like they grafted all that on for the film.
Yeah, I don't remember them mentioning that, no.
Yeah, so like, so they've layered on this like action hero background for this character. And then they hired Laura Linney. She's just like the least action-oriented person. Like if she didn't have money, like what that character, she wouldn't have been able to get out of anything. Like she just seemed like she was adrift.
Totally. Yeah. I'm like, we're supposed to buy her as this like ball busting badass bitch goddess. Hell no.
She's better written as that in the book, but still it's like very milk toast. Like just like, it's not, you don't get the sense that like she really feels strongly. It's like she's pushed to feel strongly. She didn't feel strongly to begin with, even though it's her fiance out in the jungle getting his head smashed in.
Yeah. Well, and that's the problem is like these two just sort of pasty white Wonder Bread actors are surrounded by just badass character. I mean, like Jodan Baker plays, you know, her boss. It's like Jodan Baker taking a shit is more, and it's 20 times more interesting than these two leads. I just gross myself out. God, I hate being a visual thinker. Sorry guys, but you know, but you get what I'm saying.
Yeah. Oh, I'm with you.
Oh, 100%. The leads in this movie are a problem.
Yeah, it's a very huge
and problem. It's not like Terrible Monkey and we've got at least two good solid leads. It's Terrible Monkey, terrible male lead, terrible female lead, and let's hope they don't get as much screen time as
but do
rest.
You know what the best change that the movie makes that's not in the book, not even a whiff of it in the book? Tim Curry's character is completely created for the screen, 100%.
Yeah.
Not in the book at all.
He's so good. I love him so much. Like Tim Curry is like, he's like, you know, he's an actor that could just like make a sandwich and it's going to be the most compelling thing because it's him doing it. Like Tim Curry's that breed. But
he's wasted here though. Don't you think?
He's the best part of this movie.
I think Ernie Hudson is the best part.
I think it's him and Ernie Hudson.
Ernie Hudson is a stone cold badass fox in this movie. Why wasn't Ernie Hudson? Well, Hollywood's racist, so that probably is one reason. But like Ernie Hudson, why wasn't he a big action star given lead roles? Because that dude, he's charismatic, he's good looking, he's a great actor, he's got a presence. You could buy him kicking someone's ass as opposed to Laura Linney, you know, who looks like she eats spirulina. Like,
she is spirulina in human form.
Totally. Except spirulina is really good for your gut. I've taken it. I'm not hating on spirulina.
You might be. You don't know.
Yeah.
Have you sampled Laura Linney?
Oh, I think I'm good. I know what white bread tastes like. Thank you.
Yeah, we like it. We're a whole grain podcast, baby.
I like my I keep my hot sauce.
I can't have any of it.
I like my hot sauce, aka my mayonnaise. I keep it in the refrigerator. I love Ernie Hudson. I mean, look, I might be like one of the few people who genuinely considers Ernie Hudson's Winston Zeddemore to be their favorite Ghostbuster because he's the funniest one. Like, it's funny because he's the one who doesn't believe any of this shit. And then he's just like, I believe, you know, if you pay me enough, I'll believe whatever the fuck you say. Like, if that character is not compelling outside of the three dudes who just inherently believe everything, I don't know what is. And then, you know, he never got an opportunity past that to be as big as the other three guys, because everybody just always called him the Black Ghostbuster, which is super cool.
Yeah, but he's had a, you know, he's had a really good
career. I mean, he's a great character.
Yeah. But yeah, but he's never got like an action sort of situation. But then, like, you know, which of these guys in this movie did, honestly? Like, you know,
this is the closest, really.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And he fucking nailed it. And he understands the tone of this movie better than seemingly everyone there.
Yeah.
Agreed. He stepped out of and into a modern version of King Solomon's Mines.
Yes. 100%.
Yeah.
He gets it totally.
And he pulls it off, you know?
Yeah. Oh,
but
yeah.
Like, you know, when I mentioned that the movie felt like it was from 78, like, because this sort of constant, I'm glad we've moved away from this. Like, I read a review at the time. It said, like, you know, this movie represents a thing we don't really see much anymore, the jungle adventure. And it's like, there's a reason. It's because every jungle adventure just keeps trafficking the same goddamn tropes. Like, are we going to have a tribe? Is there going to be a big tribal drumming scene with people with mud caked on them?
You know what this movie is? It is essentially a very, very dumbed down, even though it's pretty dumb in and of itself, dumbed down version of the Jungle Cruise. It's like the Jungle Cruise as a movie.
Yeah.
In a lot of ways, like it traffics in the same stuff. I'm surprised they didn't go behind a waterfall and like, look at the back of water.
Yeah.
I mean,
look, it is sort of an update.
They fight hippos at one point with flare guns. Like, I mean, what is more Jungle
Cruise
than that?
Wasn't that exciting? Isn't Frank Marshall a fantastic director?
I felt bad for that hippo. I was kind of cheering him on. I'm like, leave Ernie alone. But, you know, there's two people. You could totally go. Just go, hippo. Because think about it. What a great twist is midway through the movie. Laura Linney and Dylan Walsh get killed by an angry hippo that magically leaves everybody else alone.
It just kills them.
That would have made the movie a lot better.
I mean,
it still wouldn't have been good, but it would have been. Oh, and Amy loses the fucking gauntlet too.
I think for me, the gauntlet is definitely an unnecessary addition, but I will say it makes sense. It makes sense why they put it in the movie, right?
Yeah. I mean,
like, I totally
they're
get
updating
it.
The whole thing, right? It's all Michael Crichton's technology in the face of nature and shit.
I mean, don't you feel like calling her a talking gorilla, though, is a little bit of a cheat? Because it's like she's having to talk through this machine. Like, it's not like she's naturally on her own vocalizing. It's kind of like the singing asshole in Pink Flamingos. It's like, because in Pink Flamingos, the anus is not literally singing Surfing Bird, which was very disappointing to me in college, but whatever. You know what I'm saying, though? It's like she's not actually talking.
I've never seen Pink Flamingos.
So. Oh, Chris. It's one of my favorite movies ever. I love Pink Flamingos.
Missed out on the singing asshole, apparently.
You did.
I mean, he's not technically singing.
You won't.
It's just moving. It's like.
It's waiting for you, Chris. It's still there.
It is.
Just like Amy the Gorilla.
Yeah,
The singing anus is way better than Amy the Gorilla.
Honestly, the other kind of bigger issue that I have with, I think the biggest issue I have with this movie is it never feels like it kind of gets into a flow narratively. It feels very narratively disjointed. It's almost like a series, and the book feels this way too. So it, like, they could have done a better job adapting, obviously, in a number of ways, but it's like so narratively disjointed because it feels like they're just moving from one scenario to the other. It feels sitcom-y in a way.
Yeah. The whole thing is leading to this fucking temple. We get there and it all happens in like 10 minutes, right?
No exaggeration.
Mm-hmm. Right. And so we're all, and it's building toward this threat, these gray gorillas, these hyper violent, intelligent gorillas, which we see, don't see in the opening scene and then not again until the end of the movie. Like, what is this? What is it, Dracula? Like, and we don't know what the villain is until we get there. Like, this movie takes way too long to get there. It should have avoided, they shouldn't have had the opening scene, first of all. We should have just come in with our lead character on the ground, like into Africa and whatever, if that's the way that they were going to go. Because I'm waiting for the goddamn killer apes that never show up. We get the sort of typical bullshit of, like, you know, there's civil war and, you know, we're running the jungle.
Zaire's borders are closed to you.
Oh, my God.
No, but you know what, though? Because of that, we get the best scene in the movie. Mr. Hamoka, you are a piece of shit. Delroy Lindo steals the movie and he steals it with one scene and you never get the movie back.
No,
there are so many characters that you're like, where's that movie?
Right.
Because I want to watch that instead of the one I'm watching right now. Yeah. Yeah. He was great.
Scene directly before it when they're being interrogated. That's my favorite scene. My favorite line in the movie where he's like, this is like Kafka. And the interrogator goes, who is Kafka?
It's like a joke for an audience that wasn't coming to this movie.
Right. You know.
Like, who are you making this joke for? Also,
I guess it was for me because I thought it was really funny.
Also, like, Joey Pantoliano, Joey Pants to his friends.
Joey Pants.
And Delroy Lindo
Mommy and Daddy.
Are uncredited. Hey,
Dr. Mommy and Daddy, sir.
They're uncredited in this movie.
Which is weird.
They walk, like, Joey Pants is great too. You want to sell the gorilla?
Yeah, that's the thing. It's almost, I'm like, is this like Ron Liebman and Up the Academy where they saw the rushes and they were like, you know what? You don't have to just take my name off of it. We're good. The minute they saw that fucking gorilla, they were like, yeah, I'm good.
Well, Joey Pantoliano was on set with it, at least. Green drop drink.
Oh, God. That was awful.
That shit's not explained in the book either. Also, there is a shot in this movie of a monkey sipping a martini and smoking a cigar, which is the greatest singular shot of this film. Monkey in an airplane chair with a cigar and a martini. Like, what does this have to do with anything?
Why is her trainer grooming her by giving her Jesus juice in a martini form? Okay.
See, Heather is just thinking that the guy wants to have sex with the monkey.
Yeah.
Out of Malone.
Yeah. This is what you took from the movie. I'm doing everything in my power to blot out those characters.
Amy, sex traffic. Amy, sex traffic. Help.
I mean, that's the thing. If this was a real animal, I would not make these jokes because that would be horrifying. But this is a fake monkey and it's just a terrible character. So hence we have
the person in the suit consent to having sex with Dylan Walsh.
Oh God, that'd be so boring. You imagine, like, it'd just be like, this would be the climax. There's like a little and it's like totally like through the open flap of his
of his khakis. Of his fucking khakis.
He takes his pants off. He just like
when you're in the jungle, you don't want to expose it. Who knows what's in the jungle?
Please,
there are hippos.
By the way, speaking of that, there's a shot where they're like trekking through the jungle, and it pans over to this snake that's bothering nobody at all. And then a guy like comes in with a machete and like hacks it in half. And I'm like, what the fuck was that?
Yeah, Frank.
Like, and it's clearly they killed the snake too. Like they were on location and they killed that snake. I'm like, I don't know.
It's Frank Marshall's Cannibal Holocaust, apparently.
Really? Like,
yeah. Dude,
like, what are you doing?
Look at that guy. Snakes are awesome.
Yeah.
I'd rather watch a movie about that badass snake than, you know, ugly woman or what.
Green drop drink. Green drop drink.
Seriously, why are you giving a cocktail to an animal, sir?
Well, look, that's the least that they do. They're just like completely drugging it the rest of the time. They're stuffing downers into bananas and feeding it to the gorilla so they can fly.
Hey, that's Ernie Hudson. He's the one who goes, yeah, monkey's going to eat this and feel real good.
They do it a couple of times, though. Like, there's a further scene, like, did you give the monkey the banana? You know, like, the monkey's going to be a junkie by the end.
Dylan, did you give the monkey the banana?
God, Amy, want banana now. Amy, jittery.
Amy, withdrawing. Amy, withdrawing.
No. She sees
Amy skin. Amy feels ants.
Yeah, that's the thing. There are actually two deleted scenes in this film. One is like she has this hallucination where she jumps through a toilet and is swimming while this beautiful Brian Eno music's playing. And the other one is an interrogation scene where they put Dylan Walsh's balls in the drawer and slams it.
The monkey does. Physical sense.
The monkey slams his balls and Amy's just going, Amy, good. Amy, bad. Amy, good. Amy, bad.
Amy, mad.
Amy, ball, mad.
Ball smash.
God. But what's strange is the way the movie sells itself in the trailers is like a super serious movie. It's not embracing what does make this movie at times fun, which is campiness of it. It's like the studio couldn't do that.
The studio thought they were making Jurassic Park again, and that's how it was going to be sold, no matter what kind of movie it was. And there was no audience for this movie, right? Like, did anyone go see it? Like,
I saw it in theaters. I remember seeing it as a child in theaters.
You were like fucking 4 years old.
Yeah,
like,
it's true. I was.
You made a conscious decision to buy a ticket, dude.
I was five. The reason I remember is because my grandfather told my sister, who would have been four at the time, that the monkeys were Italian people jumping into the fire. I have no idea. Couldn't tell you. I have no earthly fucking idea. My sister. I don't know. Who
is he talking about? Man?
I have no idea. The Italians were jumping into the fire. That's what my sister would say. Who the fuck knows, dude? I have no idea. I remember seeing this movie in theaters. I will tell you that much.
You were a wee little bairn.
I was a wee lassie of five.
That's adorable. That's so cute.
Can you imagine me in a seat watching this fucking movie as a 5 year old? Just like,
yeah, this movie's
kind of heavy for a 5 year old.
Yeah,
dude, when I was like animal violence. Seven or
although,
eight,
you know,
my grandfather would show us movies. Like, I was seven when I saw Predator. Like,
oh, fucking A, Jesse Ventura. Yeah. I ain't got time to bleed.
Yeah, I mean, that's a good movie.
Mm-hmm. That's a very good movie.
But you know
what? That's a good jungle movie. That's
that
like
movie
and
this
trafficking
movie, like,
and all this shit.
Right. This movie could have been like Predator. It could have been. It just like it needed to not take itself so fucking serious.
It needed to decide what it was. And what it is a monster movie.
Yeah.
Yeah.
100%. The monkey should have been pursuing them through the jungle once, like the whole time.
Yeah. Like, I love Ernie Hudson. He did a great job with what he was given and everything. But like once Sean Connery went away, like who cares about updating this as an HR, like a Rider Haggard novel, like in 92, you know what I mean? Like why stick to the novel at all? The novel was a parody of serial films made in 1978, right after Star Wars had just done it with science fiction. So like the time was ripe for it then. Like, just take the bones of this, what was kind of okay and fun, and make it into another thing.
How much of this film's failing is Jurassic Park's fault?
None of it, because the film's terrible. I'm not going to put that on.
I asked that because of the expectations set by Jurassic Park. I'm not talking about like blame one-to-one, but like the climate at the time. I mean, you talked about Sphere, Father Malone. Why the fuck is Sphere being adapted? Because of Jurassic Park.
Yeah, exactly. Mm-hmm.
The exact same thing. I mean,
it was Jurassic Park and ER, like 1-2 punch at that moment. So like Michael Crichton was the biggest thing in the world. So like, let's grab every one of his properties and make it, you know?
Right. Oh yeah.
So we can lay 100% of the blame of the failure of this movie or failure as a movie on Jurassic Park, because nobody clearly knew what they were doing when they made this movie. They just wanted to make a movie and it was Michael Crichton.
Yeah. Also, can you think, has any movie that's had a strong Taco Bell like merchandising element?
How dare
Demolition Man.
Like I said, has any movie that's done that been good?
Oh, Demolition Man's amazing.
I like Demolition Man.
Mellow greetings.
It's fun.
You know how to use the three seashells, Heather? I don't think so.
I don't know. I mean, it's better. Well,
Are you getting it confused with Judge Dredd?
No. I actually saw Demolition Man in the theater because that whole like weird VR sex scene. I was with my parents. Is it Demolition Man with Sandra Bullock?
Yeah.
There's the scene
Oh, it's yeah. Sad. Okay. Yeah. I know what you're talking about. Yeah.
It was, and it just.
That's uncomfortable to see with your parents. I get it.
Was.
I like that movie, though.
I just didn't. I don't know.
I saw Clerks 2 with my parents.
I saw Bruno.
I saw Bruno with my parents, too.
Yeah. You know, it was hilarious when the camera zoomed in on the penis, my stepdad was laughing his ass off, and my mother looked very uncomfortable.
Bruno. Yeah, that's I just remember leaving Clerks 2 and my mom going, what the fuck did we just watch? And I was like, a guy fucking donkey. That's what we watched.
You know, I've actually seen Clerks 2, but I did see
You're the lucky man. One.
Yeah, I was about to say, I bet Father Malone has some strong opinions about
that. The chosen one. Yes. It is I. I don't know. Going back to Congo, it's Taco Bell endorsement, because apparently it's Taco Bell tie-in was the volcano burrito, which is like a I'm serious. I actually
Father Malone, you laugh. Why are you laughing, sir? Heather spent time looking this up. This is a real thing. There's a commercial and everything.
I'm not belittling the research that went into this.
It was billed as the spiciest burrito ever.
I think it's hilarious that this is a good idea. Let's call this burrito the volcano burrito.
Well, and actually, I have to give credit where credit's due. This was brought to my attention first on an episode of the Purple Stuff podcast where they talked about it. And I was like, what? There was, because I hadn't seen Congo at that point. And then when I saw the Taco Bell tie-in watching for this episode, I was like, oh,
this fucking nightmare.
And then today I looked up, I was like, what were the ingredients of this? What made it a volcano burrito? And I guess it had a spicy nacho cheese sauce called lava sauce.
Oh,
which is also what you call it when it comes out, because I'm sure it probably rips up your guts like
Dylan Walsh did with that fucking lucky.
Oh my god.
Jesus Christ.
You said it.
I know,
but you're the one who said he wanted to have sex with the monkey
Dude, you went full Project Pat on this shit. You went full hardcore rap. I'm gonna get all up in them guts.
I mean, you know what? There were tons of Congo tie-ins. There were Congo watches at Taco Bell that you could
Pepsi.
Get.
Pepsi.
Yeah. You could also get the Congo pinball machine's not half bad.
Is it? Have you played it?
Yeah, it's all right.
I love pinball.
Front and center, it has Amy.
Does she talk? Do you actually hear her voice?
Amy says, ball out. Punch the fucking back glass.
Multi-ball.
Fuck you, monkey. I'm Multi-ball. Done. Drain out.
I'm actually surprised they didn't go even harder in the film where she's like, quesorito, good.
Like, Taco Bell, yum. Taco Bell. I want Taco Bell. Amy want Taco Bell tie-in.
Yeah. Choco Taco, good. R.I.P.
Yeah, R.I.P. is right. I think the other thing about this movie, because I'm, you know, just like thinking about Jurassic Park, yeah, obviously Steven Spielberg's involved, but Michael Crichton and David Koepp wrote the script. And Michael Crichton. For Jurassic Park.
Right.
I think that also helped a lot.
David Koepp helped.
David Koepp helped.
Michael Crichton is not the best.
No.
We've already said. Okay. But yeah.
He's doing screenwriting and book writing are two different things.
They're wildly different things. And they're better for Crichton in a way because working in film, he can paper over his limitations, which is he writes terrible characters, but then you cast charismatic people to be in it. Like,
yeah.
And you know, there you go.
Jeff Goldblum, Sam Neill. I mean, that's the thing.
Go back to Westworld, Richard Benjamin and fucking
Yul Brynner.
Yul Brynner and James Brolin. It's like, you know, like the, those characters are very thinly written, but like throw Richard Benjamin, who's very interesting to watch. There you go.
And the character of Grant in the book is not as lovable as he is in the movie, but that's because you cast fucking Sam Neill. Like,
yeah.
One of the pantheon of great character actors. Who's a lead in Sam Neill's not a lead in anything else. Like Mouth of Madness, that's it.
But they possession? Like, what? Don't you make that?
No, I agree with you, but it's like the caliber of the movie is not. I mean, Jurassic Park is like one of the summer blockbusters ever.
Omen 3. Yeah.
Omen 3. He's great. He's like old Damien is like ready to take over the presidency.
I'm more talking about the fact that nowadays, look who they cast as the lead in Jurassic Park.
Oh, I know.
You see what I mean? In the 90s, it was like, let's cast Sam Neill. Like,
you guys see the new Jurassic Park?
Fuck no.
I watched it.
How was it? Was it better than Congo?
It's longer than Congo. I'll tell you that much.
It is longer than Congo. It has one really, really terrific sequence with a new dinosaur, and it's almost worth the price of admission.
Is it the airplane thing?
No.
Oh, that was the one thing I was excited for.
No, there's a dinosaur that's sort of like a long-necked animal, and it's blind, but it has four arms that taper into these really sharp claws. And there's a sequence with Jessica Chastain trying to avoid it that is, I'm going to watch it again after we finish here. But the rest of the movie is utter flaming garbage. There.
So were kind of the other two. So were kind of all the other Jurassic World Park sequels.
Yeah.
Well, except for Lost World.
No, I liked the part two is kind of okay.
Right. The rest Lost are Worlds. Trash. Yeah. We're talking about the one with Ian Malcolm, right?
Yeah. With the trailer hanging over the thing and Julianne Moore falling like
that. And the only time they ever did the dinosaurs on the mainland the right way.
Yes, exactly. Like it would be pandemonium. They were like, hey, this is Jurassic World. I keep waiting for a world where dinosaurs are running free and we got to deal with it. Like, what the hell?
And then they do it in this movie, but who cares?
Not really. Not really.
Right. Because it's not about the dinosaur.
No, it's like there's a couple of scenes of people having to interact with dinosaurs and like, you know, in a uncomfortable way. And then it's like isolated areas.
I like this idea. Do you have to deal with dinosaurs in an uncomfortable way in your daily life?
Like, you know, there's like a scene of like this brontosaurus, which I know is no longer what they call these things, but like it's just wandering through like a construction site. People are like, well, what the fuck are we supposed to do right now? You know, like that's what I mean by uncomfortable. Like, it's just it's not like rampaging. It's just like, Jesus, now we got to wait for the fucking dinosaurs.
It's also not scary for dinosaurs to be on the mainland because, like with other animals, which we've essentially pushed into small areas of the world that are uninhabited. If a dinosaur was walking through a town, someone would just fucking shoot it.
Yeah.
Like someone would call the military and be like, there's a T-Rex in our town. Can you come and kill this thing?
Right.
And it would take 2 seconds. Like, how were there stakes? And then the movie doesn't do anything with dinosaurs on the mainland. Because
it would
that's
take
not
too long for them to craft an entire world where there's now a symbiosis between man.
Yeah,
it's scary
in Jurassic Park because they're isolated. It's right. A fucking it's the horror movie. Trip.
Right.
They're
on an
island.
Only parts of this new one and the only parts of any of the other ones that work have aped that first film.
Yeah. And that's what Congo apes is Jurassic Park.
Ooh, nice one.
See, I was hoping when you said uncomfortable, like I had this image of like a dinosaur trying to hand out religious literature.
Oh, Hare Krishna style, like a Parasaurolophus with a fucking thing.
Be like, have
one
you
of
heard
the tiny ones, the spinning ones. You know, yeah.
Have you heard about God?
Yeah.
Have you heard about the kingdom of heaven?
Our Lord and Savior, Velociraptor Christ.
I'm like, God damn it. These are Mormon raptors.
Raptor Jesus.
Oh my God.
Jesus.
That'd be kind of like adorable though. Maybe. Only if it
continued to behave exactly like a velociraptor. Right.
It's
Jesus, and you go, are you sure?
Yeah.
He's played by Jim Caviezel, and he is pissed
about the January 6th riots. He's rip roaring mad.
Oh God. I always wanted them to make a sequel to The Passion where Jim Caviezel comes back as Jesus and he's all ripped and he starts crucifying people like revenge.
And it's just called Impassionate Christ. I have no passion for you.
Jesus back and he's pissed.
Dispassionate Christ.
I hope nobody gets
dispassion of the Christ.
Because honestly, our jovial talk is way less blasphemous than what most fundamentalist Christians try to do in the name of God. So
it's true.
Like make Congo.
like groom an ape for God knows what, Dylan Jesus. Walsh.
Yeah.
Hey, it's not my fault that he's given the monkey alcohol.
Hey, well, you know what they would say? The funders would be like, well, at least it's heterosexual.
Yeah, right. At least that monkey's a woman.
There you go. Everything's good in the eyes of God now.
And you know what, though? Set. I am sick and tired of these interspecies relationships because this is the second movie in a month now where I have seen a human and an animal almost attempt coitus. Howard the Duck, I'm looking at you.
Oh, God, no. No, I told you. I've told you about my PTSD from the Play Duck shit, okay?
Yeah, ugh. but I mean, I don't know why they make the joke in this movie because they never make the joke in the book. And like, it does feel like an easy joke to make. Like, oh, you know, wife and husband or whatever.
I'd fuck that duck. You know, the one in the bathtub at the beginning. She was hot.
Hey, he's raising an eyebrow at us talking about Dylan Walsh and a monkey having sex.
Well, you know, there's that.
They're closer to humans.
Monkey, and then there's an anthropomorphic like duck.
Are you just worried because the monkey could tear you apart limb from limb?
No, I'm not interested in actually having sex with a real live animal here on Earth. You know, you give me a cartoon duck, I'll have sex with her.
That's oh my God.
That shit on your fucking tombstone. If there's a cartoon duck, I'll fuck it.
I'm not into that sick shit, Chris. Okay. I just want duck titties. Okay?
I just like fucking ducks.
Hey, man, you know, like, I'm just saying, that's a better scenario. That's a better scenario than having sex with that.
Oh, yeah. What? They don't talk about that on the projector.
They don't talk about this on the
projector? They don't talk about this, yeah. Celine and Julie go boating, now with 100% more duck fucking.
Yeah.
Hey, listen, if they're reviewing Howard the Duck, that conversation needs to happen because the filmmakers decided we need to start thinking about duck sex.
And you know what? To Heather's credit, they bring up the guy and the monkey fucking in this movie. So we had to have a conversation about it.
It's not
and
my
it
fault.
Could be interpreted that way. I mean, it could be. Okay. If it were a better movie.
But maybe we've interpreted it a little too much.
Right? Maybe we spent too much whatever, time thinking about it.
Whatever, Mr. Ooh, I love that sexy duck woman with her duck yeah. boobs and Howard the Duck.
Listen, I haven't been talking about it ad nauseum. I just spoke about it a little bit.
Oh, yes.
My point isn't that that we shouldn't have the conversation about the monkey sex. I'm just saying... Why is it dominating our conversation?
Because you keep bringing it up, Chris, and I just made the initial observation.
It's true. I think I've brought it up more than anybody else. What about Grant? Yeah. What about Grant Heslop? Yeah, it's true. What about Grant Heslop?
Oh my God, he's good in this,
right?
Yeah, I've always loved that guy, and like he's doing good stuff now, you know, like as a filmmaker.
He is an Oscar-winning filmmaker, I believe. Argo. Does that sound right?
Yeah. Did he do that one?
I think he was a producer for Argo.
Maybe wrote it. Maybe
with George, with he's Mr. Clooney. Mm-hmm. He's great. Yeah, he's not. Nobody's given much to do in this movie other than the leads. And then them having a lot to do ends up being the biggest problem with the movie overall.
Oh, God.
Imagine if they had they had fallen out of the plane or something. And then we just meet Ernie Hudson. He's like, they have a map.
Ooh, I mean, there was a stunt that somebody had to do in this movie that was jumping out of an airplane with a fake monkey strapped to your chest. So
that was amazing.
That was something someone got paid for.
That was beautiful. Can you imagine what if they like had done sort of like a Donner Party Alive situation very early on,
also directed by Frank Marshall,
the plane crashes early on and everybody eats Laura Linney and Dylan Walsh because they're the most boring.
I would love that movie. We would have reviewed this movie long ago for my ultimate praise of seeing Laura Linney devoured by cannibals.
And the best joke is at the end somebody's like, well, how did they taste? And one of them just goes, needed a little bit of seasoning because they're bland.
Got it. Yeah. Yeah.
They're like,
As one of them picks their teeth with his bones, like.
I mean, sir, did these two bone somebody to get cast in this movie?
I honestly, the more I think about
they were like hot people at the time because
is that what it is?
Yes. If you remember, this was like the independent film thing. It just like exploded everywhere. Everything was independent and like they were snatching up everyone who was like starring in those movies. And obviously Laura Linney like went on to bigger and bigger stuff. So that was obvious, but like Dylan fucking Walsh, blah.
Yeah.
But I guarantee you that's how they got on the radar because they had been in some indie shit.
Yeah, but I don't know. It's almost like if you're going to cast like a white bread actress, like a Helen Hunt would have made more sense because she'd done Twister. I mean, she had more of a name.
Hey, Helen Hunt could have been good in this movie.
Yeah, she's better than Laura Linney.
I know who wrote Twister. We know who wrote Twister, sir. I love Twister.
Twister's a fun movie. I like
it. It's better than this movie.
It's a hell of a lot better than this movie.
This, like, that's what this movie should have been, honestly. Yes.
And I hate Twister, but
I know you hate Twister.
Yeah.
The game and the...
What about the other movie called Twister?
Oh, I know. Take that back immediately.
you like Twister, the game?
Only when the women are dressed up like ducks.
They don't have to be dressed like ducks. They can be dressed like any animals they want. Yes. As long as there's a Twister involved.
Okay.
Okay.
He did right.
I don't know. It's not a bit I'm doing. I'm just
that was the last.
And I want you to take it back.
My bits here tonight. Is this a good bit, duck tits?
He's like, it's not a bit. I'm 100% serious. You dress up. All this pretty ladies dress up like an animal. I'll twist all night.
I'm not a furry. That's not what I'm saying. I'm saying if I were given the opportunity to be in the Howard the Duck universe and that duck lady wanted to have sex with me, I would say yes.
Are you a duck in this universe or are you human?
No, I'm human.
Okay. You're just you.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, that's, you know, that's the thing.
Leah Thompson almost fucks Howard the Duck.
And right? That's the thing, so, I said in the Howard the Duck podcast, I said, which is a Patreon episode if you want to listen to it for $1. Like the romance between the two is kind of endearing. Like it kind of works. Like
it's kind of sweet, actually.
Yeah. You know? As opposed to what we get in this movie, which is, you know.
Yes, but that movie is actually about that. This movie is not about monkeys. It's
Isn't it, though?
If you listen to Justin's
podcast. Isn't that what happens at the end of the movie? Like, Amy goes away with the other monkey because she's like, I'm his bitch now.
Okay, I guess ultimately it is about monkey sex, but it wasn't really. It was
That's fair.
God. I've said monkey sex way too much.
Have you said Tim Curry getting his head smashed by a monkey enough, though?
No, because I never want to say those words.
That's when the movie kind of is the most fun, is in the climax.
Right? The 10 minutes of climax.
Right. Yeah, but that, to me, it's like, that's what the movie could have been, like throughout. Yeah,
mm-hmm. Absolutely. It should have been them being attacked by apes for 2 hours, you know? And then they figure out what it is.
Yeah.
Instead of this nonsense about this, all the political intrigue and getting down the river and all that shit. Like, who cares? Get to the fucking monkeys. That's why we're here.
Yeah. Well, and what if you actually
get to the fucking monkeys as well?
Like, they did not know what the fucking plot of this movie was. Like,
it doesn't have one. That's what I'm saying. Like, it feels like vignette.
And like John Patrick Shanley, he is a, let's say, an unusual choice as a screenwriter for an action adventure throwback with a technological edge. Like, let's get the guy who wrote Moonstruck. Like,
and Doubt, both the play and the movie.
Yeah, like the twin pillars of action heroism.
Well, that and the film that he wrote before this one was Throw Back the Clock to the Dawn of Time and Sing This Song with Me. We're Back, featuring John Goodman as an anthropomorphic T-Rex.
You wrote that?
Sure did.
What a weird career. I'm surprised they didn't work on Theodore Rex.
Too. Yeah, We're Back is a fucking fever dream of a film.
Like, when you say that was the movie he wrote previously, that's probably the movie he wrote like 5 movies back, because it was animated and took like 4 years to make, probably, right?
Have you seen it? I'm not sure it took more than like a day to make. I mean, I'm kidding. I'm sure it took a very long time, but it is like
there are some animators out there who I bet did like really sincere work.
That movie's like a fucking fever dream.
Oh, I've never seen it.
I wasn't even familiar with it.
Oh,
man. Oh. The things you learn.
That would be a movie worth checking out, because it's another movie that has like a crazy cast. John Goodman, Charles Fleischer, Walter Cronkite, Jay Leno, Julia Child, Kenneth Mars.
What?
Yeardley Smith doing a child voice. Martin Short is in there as well. Yeah. Yeardley Smith's voice is hilarious because it's like, it's just Lisa Simpson, essentially.
Yes.
No two ways around.
Mm-hmm. Like, Julie Kavner pretends that she isn't Marge at this point, but she's just Marge at this point.
Julie Kavner can barely talk at this point. I don't know if you've seen any recent episodes of The Simpsons, but it's unpleasant. It's because her voice doesn't have the same power that it used to, and they haven't found a way to replace her and let her go and enjoy the millions of dollars.
Do they need to keep making that show? Hasn't it been on for more than 20 years? Like, what are they doing? Stop it already.
I don't know. I haven't watched an episode of The Simpsons recent since like 10 years.
I checked out in season 13.
Yep. Sounds about right. That's about when the show started getting bad.
And I've not looked back. I haven't.
17 plus years ago.
Yeah. I haven't even checked in to see if it's, I was just like, that's it. They'll never get back to where they
were. We should do an episode on We're Back. You guys would probably find it immensely strange.
If we can also do one on Collision Course.
The Jay Leno Pat Morita movie?
No.
I've never seen it.
I haven't either.
Oh, wait. Heather has, though.
No, I well, actually, that was one of the movies I've ever seen parts of on HBO, and I could never finish it. And keep in mind, I was able to finish Rat Boy and Armed and Dangerous multiple times.
Boy, Rat Boy hurts, but I like Armed and Dangerous.
Rat Boy's depressing. Rat Boy. Oh, God. Directed by Sandra Locke.
I know.
which is crazy.
What very is sad. Rat boy?
You know, it's a movie about a boy who looks like a rat in New
and
York
he's
City.
Exploited. He's exploited by people, and it's awful. That film kind of
it's very up. Earnest. It's very sentimental and
definitely
you know,
trauma. It's very as a child.
It's very serious.
Yeah, Armed and Dangerous. The main thing I remember is that scene where Eugene Levy's wearing assless chaps.
Yeah,
and it's John a good Candy's. Scene. Yeah, and John Candy's basically divine.
Yeah,
which is kind of cool.
Mm-hmm.
And he made a great Divine on SCTV.
He did.
Yeah. This movie had been better if it had just been John Candy dressed up like a gorilla.
This movie would have been better if John Candy in general. John Candy's charismatic.
Not that gorilla, though.
Can you imagine John Candy just playing a gorilla, but just John Candy?
Yes.
Just them at him
just, like no
just,
costume?
It's just a tacit agreement between audience and
that he's a gorilla.
That he's a gorilla. We go.
Yeah, he's a gorilla. Okay.
I'd watch it, you know what? The effectiveness effect, it would be the same, right? Because we're not at no time ever during the course of this film does anyone think that's a live, real gorilla.
No. And like, I wonder what the test screenings of this movie were like. Oh, do you think people were like, the monkey is terrible? Like, the monkey is awful? Or do you think people were like, a monkey is my favorite part. Monkey, super endearing.
I would love to read those cards.
Burn them.
Let him know how you feel.
Yeah, set him on fire. Just watch it burn. Yeah. This monkey's just. I don't. I'm just curious. Like, why anybody thought? You know, that's the thing with films like this, because a lot of times people will pick when they say the worst movies on low budget films, which is low hanging fruit, because it's like, well, these are independent usually filmmakers that are just working with what they have. So I think that's kind of shitty.
But what are they supposed to do?
Right. But then you have like these Hollywood films where the budgets are multi-millions of dollars. Like, you could take the budget for Congo and give it to a third world country and people will have food for a year. People will have homes, you know, like it's obscenely expensive. And you have all of these people that are like trained technicians, cast crew of hundreds, and it's still, these decisions were still made. Like, somebody was like, that's the voice we want to go with for the gorilla. That's this, that's that. Let's cast the two most bland motherfuckers. I mean, seriously, like, I'm amazed Paltrow isn't in it. I'm amazed they didn't get her, because it's like about that level of just like,
she would be better. She would have been better than Laura Linney in this role.
It's shocking how Kara's like, again, like we were talking about, like Jurassic Park, like contrast this with Jurassic Park, like Laura Dern and Sam Neill, like,
wonderful.
Yeah. Again, like they're both character actors and they're being given like the lead role in the movie and they rise to the occasion. And then some, if you're Dylan Walsh or Laura Linney, it's like, make this fun.
Yeah.
Amy, monkey needs help. What are we supposed to do?
Like, that other set of actors also had a skilled filmmaker guiding them, like, and letting them know what their movie actually is, as opposed to Frank Marshall, who, you know.
He's a good producer.
He is a good producer.
But he's no Frank Darabont.
He's very good at producing Steven Spielberg's movies. So, right. You know what I mean? Like, he's good at facilitating this guy when getting him what he wants. It's like Rick McCallum is a good producer. He produced three movies that made billions of dollars.
I think we might have overdone it, Rick.
What did he do in that movie other than go get coffee, you know?
Right. Go get George coffee, Rick. Yes, sir. Pretty much. I mean, but at the end of the day, like, his name's still on the project, which means that gives you cachet.
And he's done other good stuff. I don't mean to just be like railing against Frank Marshall here, but like,
he did direct 8 Below.
Yeah. This movie is bad and he should be ashamed.
8 Below is a movie with Paul Walker and dogs. So I don't know if it's better than this movie.
I don't know that. No, I mean, look, he's made worse movies than this, but this is kind of egregious. Like I said, like, and what you were just saying, Heather, is so true. Like, this isn't a movie from 1978 and they didn't know what the fuck they were doing with special effects. This is a movie from like 95 from the guy who just produced Jurassic Park.
Yeah.
Everything should be sparkling in this movie. All the visual effects should be serving the story in a real and interesting way instead of this like nonsense B movie that they spent like not even they like that's a lot of money to be spending on what we got.
50 million?
God. Yeah. Come on, man.
I mean, at least the goddamn movie's coming out. What was that? 90 million for that movie? And that movie is never going to see the light of day? I mean, come on.
What movie is this?
The Batgirl movie? They dropped $90 million on it.
It was always just going to be streaming, right? It wasn't going to be theatrically released. They're saying like it's not going to be released, but they're just not going to put it on.
Yeah, probably.
They're not going to put it on TV. And I say they've now joined the ranks of the Fantastic Four. There's another superhero movie that never got released.
Yeah, technically. I mean, it's
you plus can that watch movie it. Was going to be terrible. You know.
Yeah.
It's another DC movie from the rudderless, you know, studio that has no idea what their characters are actually about.
The whole thing with Jurassic Park was they got into like a massive bidding war before the book came out, right?
Yeah.
So this is just Paramount going, we lost the bidding war for Jurassic Park. Yes. What's another Crichton right. property?
Yeah. I think they already owned it, actually, because when it was pitched as a novel, it wasn't pitched as a novel. It was pitched as a movie. And like his publisher was like, that's a great novel. That would make a good book. That should be your next book. But the property itself originated with this studio. So I think they already had it. So they were like, we have a Crichton property. Like, let's make this immediately.
Right. Well,
who cares if we can or can't actually make what they made in this book?
Yeah.
Well, that's to quote Bougie Boy, from the band Devo. This is what happens when people's eyes get bigger than their belly.
Yeah, there you go.
The success of Jurassic Park was so immense, like I can't necessarily blame them.
Right. I mean, it is printing money and this movie did well.
I mean, it's 2022 and a Jurassic Park movie came out in the last 6 months. Like,
right.
Tell me why they wouldn't do every Michael Crichton book that they could get their fucking hands on.
I think they have at this point.
There's a couple they haven't. Prey, State of Fear, Next. I think those, and Airframe. I think those are the four that they have never approached.
And I bet Airframe was optioned at least. And then they were like,
I'm sure those
nothing happens in this.
Yeah. Well, I'm sure they were all optioned at some point.
Yeah.
Right. Again, that's the thing about Michael Crichton. You know, Stephen King is the most adapted author of all time, but Michael Crichton is almost completely adapted. Like all of his books he's written.
Yeah. And he's made original movies on top of that, like, yeah, you know, sort of separate from them. So
yeah. And like you mentioned, ER. Yeah. And Michael Crichton's an interesting author. I think ultimately though, Jurassic Park is a good movie. Yeah. And that's a problem for a lot of other adaptations for Michael Crichton. Nothing else ever even comes close to Jurassic Park.
What was that? What was that horrible one with the Paul Walker where they like went back
timeline.
In time? Oof. Ah, man.
Yeah, that was real. That was rough. Yeah, that's the worst Crichton movie, period. I think without even a close contender.
Yeah.
It's worse than this. And this is like, I can completely understand people don't like this movie and why. But like that timeline is like unconscionably bad.
Right. Yeah. If we're comparing things here, like, yeah, this is really good.
Yeah. But and now we're essentially with Jurassic Park and Westworld. And like I'm not sure they're going to revisit any Crichton stuff maybe down the road. But I mean, he's passed away, obviously. So there's nothing else new for him to write. So,
yeah, I don't think any of his other properties are really worth revisiting. The Westworld is the best possible version they could have done of that original material, I think.
Right, so. Which is doing something drastically different with it.
Yeah.
Which is, again, but, like what I've been preaching recently, which is stop remaking stuff that was amazing. Just take stuff that's like middle of the road and do something different with it. Do it a completely different way.
Remake Congo.
Really? Like, yeah, make it the movie where they fight a bunch of fucking monkeys in the jungle. Like, why not?
Yeah.
And cast good people in it as the leads.
Yeah.
So funny, I was reading about the making of it, and you know, they said that like their big problem in making the film was they kept having to reject the designs for the gray killer apes.
Right.
And they had trouble making them, and they couldn't differentiate them. Originally, that we were supposed to be able to just look at them and know one from the other and all this stuff. And I'm like, those apes look fine. Like
but they don't look like anything special.
No, other than the fact that it's clear that there are stuntmen with elongated rubbery arms that look so fucking ridiculous.
It looks like the Lion King on stage.
Right.
Like,
it's all here's the thing. Like, if you could have taken all of Rod Bottin's work from The Thing and shot it really poorly. And people would be like, that movie was awful and the effects were terrible. But like here, that's what's going on. It's shot so awfully that everything looks terrible. But like the design of the apes looked okay to me as far as the killer apes. Like that was their contention. Like when they look and they had Amy on screen for like 90% of the runtime. Like,
I wanted to mention, and I kind of keep forgetting to mention it. She has like a really upsettingly human face in a way that like gorillas don't.
Right.
Because we see other monkeys in the movie. We see other non-aggressive gorillas because they make a point saying gorillas are not aggressive.
Nice gorillas.
Hello, sexy gorilla, make love. And then they show the gray gorillas, which are weird, you know, weird looking, but they make Amy look like neither. And she looks like a human being that like turned into an ape. I don't know how else to describe it. That's why it's so bad, I think, is because the ape looks so weird and like upsetting.
My dog has very strong opinions apparently about this. Sorry.
Yeah, he's really
Congo.
Fuck this shit.
But it just hit me. She almost kind of reminds me of like a high budget version, obviously, of the if you watch Boggy Creek 2, The Legend Continues, you see a baby Boggy Creek monster. She kind of looks like the baby a little bit.
It's a really bad design. And again, like you've mentioned, Father Malone, this is the lead character of the movie.
Right. And let me reiterate, the character is immaterial to the film.
Right? 100%. Because 100%.
Ultimately, it's about fighting these apes and getting this diamond and this laser thing. And the Amy stuff is like B plot. So like, why even have it? Like, why distract the audience with this animatronic nightmare for 2 hours? Like, spare us that.
How would you fix the movie then? Would you just cut everything? I would have the movie just open with them going to the jungle.
Yeah.
And tell it in like a backstory when they're on the plane of like why they're doing what they're doing.
Right. And like, and then, you know, if you want the intrigue, you know, then we've got the Tim Curry character and all these, like this movie should have been a rescue mission because a team went down there. Right. And then they're getting fucked with the entire time as they try and figure out.
We didn't even mention that there's a moment where they go, oh yeah, look, there's the other plane of the other team that they sent that got blown up.
Yeah.
That's just like completely just thrown away.
By the way, if anyone shoots a missile at you, just shoot a flare.
That's a great scene.
Well, and with Laura Linney again, it's just whatever.
Like, when it shows her standing next to Ernie Hudson aiming the guns, I'm like, that's supposed to look so cool, but it looks so lame because it's Laura Linney.
It's so out of place. She just looks like she should not be holding a pistol.
No,
and that's not to say that like actresses like Laura Linney are like, it's like you need to stay in your lane and be this one type of role. But like, if you're gonna be in this movie, read the fucking like tone of the script,
right?
Because like, there's clearly the tone of the script. Some people get the tone of the script, like Ernie Hudson gets it. They're all reading the same fucking script.
I wouldn't have believed Laura Dern could have been an action hero, but then she did that in Jurassic Park. Like,
she's immensely charming.
If she would have been in this role and went to the door with the pistol, I would have believed her.
Oh, yeah.
Because she would have believed it. Laura Linney doesn't have time for any of this make-believe nonsense.
That's kind of what it feels like. It feels like she doesn't believe that it's actually a monkey, that Amy is a person in a suit.
Right. I don't think she believes anything that's going on here with lasers and monkeys and volcanoes and stuff. She's just like, what is this? I'm just cashing my check because I finally made it.
Well, and then the whole thing is like, we're supposed to buy that Bruce Campbell is her ex-fiance.
I can believe that.
I can believe him ditching.
the ex part, yeah.
Yeah. But then like, you know, the whole thing is like, she's going there to try and find him and Joe Don Baker's the father. But then it's just kind of like shoehorned in, and then it comes back up at the end. Like, it's so, you don't buy her being sad. You don't buy her being mad. She's just like on one, just like one layer.
Yeah. Like, it should be this moment of vengeance at the end, right? Like, I'm destroying your satellite in addition to all of this stuff. Like, I've destroyed your whole world. And it's just like, ugh, Laura Linney. That's like all I could think.
And that's all for the movie. Like in the book, the volcano explodes and that's it. Like it's just the right. volcano exploding gets rid of the diamonds and the monkeys and Zinj and anything. And like there is no, you know, there's no her having one and saying, oh, you know, fuck you. You didn't actually care. And then well, I think in the book, the Ernie Hudson character at the end is like, it's that whole thing. Like at the end of the 1999 Mummy where they have like a bag of diamonds. He has like a box of diamonds at the end of the book and he sells them and then he's super rich, which is like a much better way for the story to end.
Yeah, you think.
And Amy goes off into the wild.
When she hands the blue diamond, this gigantic thing that's obviously worth more than anything on planet Earth, and hands it to Dylan Walsh and goes, throw that away for me. I would have been like, yeah, okay, and put it in my pocket. Like, where is the benefit for that? Like, they've taken it, they've already destroyed the bad guy's bullshit. Just take that and be rich.
And there's not even a bad guy in the movie, is there?
Joe Don Baker is the bad guy, frothing at the mouth.
But we barely see him. Like, it's ridiculous. Well, and also,
those monkeys.
I think it's the monkeys.
Yeah, they're the villains.
But also, like, think about this, like, the balls to throw these diamonds off in a third world country. Like, you couldn't give that to one of the people that have helped you out, especially given what happened to the actual Congo in, you know, a year after this movie came out.
One also
already going on, and they kind of like touch on it a little, like, oh well, yeah. The Congo, you know, what are you gonna do? It's like, well, don't make a movie called Congo when there's actual genocide going on.
And then you have all of the helpers, the porters are the ones who get murdered.
Yeah.
Like what? Like it's just a tad problematic movie.
Well, and not to mention like the Hollywood style. There's like Hollywood African music.
Yeah.
Where it's like, yeah.
It's like if you go to Animal Kingdom, a Disney World. Yeah, it's that shit where it's like, this is fake.
Yeah.
Jumbo Safari. It's like, this is fucked. Like, this is fake. It's like, you know what? There's an actor in this movie who's in George of the Jungle.
And that is Brendan Fraser.
Michael Chinyamirindi. He plays one of the porters, but he's the one who's with Grant Heslov when he gets murdered. But he plays the guy in George of the Jungle who's like, you know, funny white man fall down, go laughing, everybody laugh on three. Like, he's better in that movie than in this one, but it speaks to that thing you're talking about, Heather, where it's like, this is like Africa through the lens of Hollywood. It's like they're not even trying. This is clearly a backlot somewhere.
Yeah.
I mean it's clearly Costa Rica, but you know, it's clearly not. This is not being shot in Africa.
Well, and it's, again, it kind of goes back to what you were saying, Father Malone, where, yeah, a film like this would fly 30 years ago. But in the 90s, like, you either just go full tilt boogie and make it the most absurd piece of cinema or take it seriously. But this, like, middling shit, it's just you end up getting, you know, other than, like, the great actors that you do see in the film, it's more of a flat effect.
Who are in a different movie.
Yeah.
Like, all the good actors are effectively in that movie that we're talking about. But the movie that this is the Dylan Walsh and Laura Linney show. Ugh. And so it never moves outside of, you know, the good character actors are here doing, like, barely anything because we have the main actors just being given carte blanche to just override anything fun the movie could ever have done.
Yeah, they are a terrible loss in the center of the movie.
Yeah, because like the Delroy Lindo thing is fun. Tim Curry is fun. Ernie Hudson's obviously like the only saving grace of the main cast because he comes close to being the third lead, fourth lead, I guess, if we're counting the monkeys. So
no,
you have to with her blue backpack. Monkey, love you.
I'm surprised I didn't have her be a Hulk Hogan fan.
I would love for Michael Crichton to explain why the cigar and the martini are important, but yet here we are. So Father Malone, final thoughts on Congo.
Sorry I watched.
Wow.
Keeping it real.
Fair. At least it wasn't 2 hours. Or almost more three. Like
158.
At least it wasn't like Jurassic World Dominion, which is almost 3 hours
long. Oh, Jesus Christ. No film like that should ever be... That I honestly, popcorn movies, 90 minutes.
But you don't understand. It's two franchises coming together. It's Jurassic Park people and Jurassic World people. You can't do that in 2 hours.
Jurassic World's characters that are so memorable, they have to remind them of their names every time they come on screen. Hey, that's Owen Grady, remember?
Is that what his name is?
Yeah, right, exactly.
I just spent 3 hours with him. I got no idea.
Call him Chris Pratt.
Chris Pratt, Jessica Chastain.
And it's not even Jessica Chastain, bro.
Is that? Yes, it is.
That's Dallas Bryce Howard.
No, it's not.
Yes, it is. Jessica Chastain would only go and be an it. Come on.
You are incorrect.
This no, is, it's Dallas Jessica Bryce Howard. No,
I think he, I haven't, well, great. I haven't seen, honestly, I've only seen Jurassic Park. I
ask yourself if sequels. Jessica Chastain is running in pumps, bro. That's Dallas Bryce Howard and you know it.
Is it?
Yeah.
Yeah, also
they really are interchangeable, aren't they?
Well, I think she kind of does like more interesting films. Like, I mean, she worked with Guillermo del Toro. Yeah. See?
Who did? This, your dog is just like, fuck this. Fuck your monkey shit. So, Heather, give your final thoughts on Congo, if you can.
If you dare.
If you dare.
My my partner in crime over here, Mr. Brody Lee. Roberts has some strong opinions, too.
Yeah, he's
not.
Brody, angry. Brody, angry.
Don't you dare. You take my you take my dog's name out of your goddamn mouth.
Brody, want food. Brody, want green drop drink.
Chris, I will haunt your dreams, dude. Like, talking,
I want green drop drink at this point.
I'm talking about like some green drop absinthe at this point to get through.
Green drop drink. That's, you know what? When we get this movie programmed at the Alamo Draft House, we'll be like, can you guys put together a cool cocktail for the night? The green drop drink?
Oh, Jesus.
I'm going to order martinis that way from now on. Can I get syrup? Green drop drink.
You know. And they'll be like, sir, we're going to have to ask green you to leave.
The vodka and vermouth, you know, green drop drink.
With the green drop in it. Then you put the green
drop. Drop a green drink. Green drop drink.
I fucking hate that so much. That's my opinion on the green drop drink. the movie, I think, is it's an exercise in failure with some bright spots.
Yeah.
How's that?
It's fair.
Yeah. How's that? That's what Frank Marshall said to everybody in the theater after the final test showing. How's that, guys?
Either that, he'll like, it'll do.
Yeah. Spielberg just goes, well, I picked the right fucking movie to direct.
Well, this had been offered to him. So,
this had been offered to Spielberg. So, which is funny. And it was also offered to John Carpenter, of all people.
Wow. Would have been better.
Yeah.
Would have been better.
Would have been something.
He would have said, this needs to be a horror movie.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, and it would have been made in the 80s, too, because that's when they offered it to him. So this movie feels like, you know, I mentioned those things at the end because it feels like a missed opportunity because this could have been a lot more. And even when they made it, it could have been a lot more, even in the shadow of this immense monolith of a franchise that is Jurassic Park, a franchise that exists now, that people, that children are seeing. That's their first Jurassic Park movie is Jurassic World. Like, that's how prolific and important, I guess, Jurassic Park is. I think the newest movie may have diminished the importance of Jurassic Park, but in the 90s, it was the fucking shit. And that's why this movie is kind of shit, because there's no way it was going to be as good as Jurassic Park. Like, it's just, it's unfortunate. This movie's not very good, but it also suffers from being related to the movie from the 90s that I think I've brought up on this show more than anything else, because it's a standard bearer for a lot of things that have come since. Practical effects, CGI in the 90s. Most of the time you watch a movie in the 90s, you go, well, how did Jurassic Park do this better if they essentially had the same budget? And it's like, okay, like,
industrial, that's what, light and magic.
Exactly. So Congo suffers from being related to something way too good, really.
Yeah. Yeah, but and just has all the trappings of it without the core thing.
It which doesn't is, understand which is what it ILM. Wants to be.
If ILM had done this, it would have been maybe a little bit different. And they shouldn't have hired Stan Winston. I read like press stuff at the time where they were like, they were bagging on Rick Baker, like, oh, you know, none of our apes are going to have human eyes. Like, we've gone the extra mile. Like, Rick Baker's apes are emotive and beautiful characters, and you've got an animatronic monkey nightmare.
When Chris Pontius in Jackass 3 is a more convincing ape for 5 minutes in a gag than this monkey is for an hour and a half in a highly produced fucking Hollywood film, you've got problems.
I love Chris Pontius.
Yeah, me too.
He's way better than Amy and her green drop drink.
Goddamn green. And her fucking cigar.
That was weird. I didn't like that. If you're going to see a monkey smoke, you should watch Alice Cooper's music video for Elected. It's way better than Congo. Just saying.
Most good things song. Are better than Congo.
True. That's true.
So what are we talking about on the next episode? Whose turn is it?
I believe it's Father Malone's.
Oh.
Because I picked subspecies.
La Planète Sauvage?
Hmm.
Pamplemousse.
Pamplemousse.
What should it be?
Green drop drink?
No.
You want to do, what was that? What's the Antonio Banderas, Michael Crichton one? The 13th Warrior.
I like that movie.
I like that movie too. That's a good movie. Yeah. That's a fun movie for what it is.
That's better than his book. It's still not a great movie, but it's an interesting movie. I had fun watching them.
Convince me why the next movie we watch isn't The Mask of Zorro.
The Antonio Banderas movie?
Yeah.
Because I'm not going
to
watch that movie.
Because I don't hate either of you enough to force you to watch it.
Yeah, I would never make anybody watch that movie.
I feel so loved.
I don't know. Let me think. Trying to roll back in my head here. Something y'all might enjoy.
Doing like a Beetlejuice thing?
I don't know. Like, what are you?
Keeps getting funnier every time I see it.
What do you guys?
Your book sounded like Stone Cold.
In the mood for? Like a genre. Give me a genre.
Oh, a genre. Heather, you go for it. Monkeys talking monkey films.
Where
they drink green drop drink?
No, I'm good on that soft genre. Well, we did horror last. We've done fail Hollywood blockbuster here. Right. So I think
its own category.
That leaves us musicals, leaves us comedies.
Let's do a musical show.
I love it. Ooh, what do you want to do?
Chris and I have done a bunch of musicals.
So. Sweeney Todd.
You want to do Sweeney Todd?
No. If you wanted to, I like Sweeney Todd. That's the problem.
I love Sweeney Todd.
Yeah.
I hate that movie. So
yeah.
You want to duke it out? Because that's what it's going to be.
I mean, I like the movie, but it's not a hill worth.
Yeah, you know what? I actually don't want to waste my time talking about
it. It's like 2.5 hours long. That movie's a bit much. It's like, in my mind, it's like the last good thing Tim Burton did. Like, thing that's like kind of defensibly good. I know you like Dark Shadows.
I like Dark Shadows. I like Dumbo.
Heather's face.
Have you seen Dumbo?
In fairness, I didn't see it, but I hated the cartoon as a kid. So,
but did you see the film? The Tim Burton film?
I'm good.
No, I haven't.
No, I don't want to see it.
It has this crazy takedown of like Walt Disney in the movie. Like Michael Keaton basically plays Walt Disney in the film. It's kind of fun and meta and weird. Like, I don't know. I enjoyed the movie. It isn't the cartoon. It's not that at all. Musical.
I mean, Heather doesn't sound game, but I would do it at some point if you wanted to.
Yeah, man. I'll be in.
CGI fucking elephant.
Yeah, I mean, I watched it once when it came out. I want to rewatch it again and see if I'm not crazy for liking it as much as I do.
Pick a musical that Heather, you've seen a lot of musicals, right?
Some. I'm very picky. I'm very picky. The musicals that I love fiercely. But there's a lot of musicals I don't like. So, but I'm interested. Father Malone has fascinating tastes and he's seen probably way more than I have.
Yeah.
You've seen Bugsy Malone?
I haven't, but you guys have talked about it already.
It's a great movie.
Yeah, really we've talked about it, but
we didn't have any fun talking about
but
it.
But I think Father Malone would make a case that would be an episode worth redoing.
A redo? Is this my redo? It's like my Tales from the Crypt.
I don't know. I mean, let me put it this way. Do you think if we did another episode on Bugsy Malone, there would be something worth talking about between the three of us?
Yeah.
2/3 of us have already talked about it. But again, like, I would be game to do Bugsy.
All right, let's do Bugsy Malone. I'll watch Bugsy Malone. You in, Heather?
Absolutely.
I'll watch Bugsy Malone, says the guy who's already watched it once this year, at least.
I will watch it again.
How many times have you watched it this year?
I haven't seen it.
Really? Mm-mm. You could have been anything that you wanted to be.
I know. Don't it make your heart glad that we decided a fact we take pride in? We became the best at being bad. Come on, it's Alan Barker. It's absolute lunacy. You'll enjoy it.
No, I'm game.
Let's do it. Bugsy Malone.
Now I have an excuse to watch it. I'm such an insane human.
Someone once said if it was raining brains, Roxy Robinson wouldn't even get wet. Roxy had spent his whole life making 2 and 2 into 5, but he could smell trouble like other people could smell gas. But believe you's me, he should have never taken that blind alley by the side of Perito's Bakery.
Your name Robinson?
Roxy Robinson.
You work with Fat Sam?
Whatever game it was everybody was playing, sure as eggs is eggs, Roxy the Weasel had been scrambled.
He's a sinner, candy coated. For all his friends, he always seems to be alone. But they love him, Bugsy Malone. A city slicker, he can charm you with a smile and a style all his own. Everybody loves that man, Bugsy Malone.
Now, my friends, I should be filling you in a little. This guy you're looking at is the hero of our story, name of Bugsy Malone. A nice guy, a little too popular with the broads for my liking, but a nice guy. An Italian mother, an Irish father, he naturally grown up a little confused, kind of mixed up. Oh, by the ways, I nearly forgot, my name's Sam, Fat Sam, on account of my physique. I ain't no dumb bum, and between you and me, this ain't no bookstore. This is my place. Fat Sam's Grand Slam, best joint in town.
Hi, Jelly.
Hi, Bubsy.
Anybody who is, anybody will soon walk through that door at Fat Sam's Grand Slam. Speak easy.
Until then, Heather, where could people find you if they were looking?
That always sounds so unsettling when you phrase it that way.
Where can they find you?
If they were looking for you.
If they're on your trail, where should they begin?
Well, you can find me at my homepage, which is www.mondoheather.com. You can also find my work as well as a podcast I co-host with Kat Ellinger on diabolicmagazine.com. Our podcast is Hell's Bells, and we are back. We have a new episode that literally went live today and or yesterday, and it's amazing, and it's all about how punk rock has affected our lives. You can also find me on Twitter and Instagram under @MondoHeather.
What about you, Father Malone?
FatherMalone.com. You can find my video podcast, Wolf and Raisin, the Banachek podcast. You can also find Dark Destinations, which is the half-hour radio drama that I write and produce. And also there's links to, I don't know, 3-4 dozen shows that Chris and I do.
Yeah. As for me, cstashu.com is my link tree. Though I was thinking, do you think congomovie.com is taken anymore? Because I could change my link tree to that.
But why would you?
Why not? What if I just not change it, but I just said, if you also want to find me, go to congomovie.com.
Are you going to now buy all the links for the movies that we do? Like, because I'm sure that like they're super obscure, like Bugsy Malone is taken because that's still viable property.
I doubt it.
No, because in England, they're crazy about that movie and they put on productions Cuckoo all the Bugsy. Time. Yeah. So I'm sure BugsyMalone.com is, take.
congomovie.com probably not take it, so we'll see, but cstashy.com and then culturecast.com for all the other stuff for this show, patreon.com, you know, the whole thing, $1, blah blah blah. If you want to, great. If not, rate and review the show on iTunes, because that's what really matters. Personal vindication or being called a nasally bitch, you take your pick. I don't know.
Somebody call you nasally?
No, but they called Mike nasally, which feels like an attack on all of us. We want to kill anybody who goes after Mike White, right?
Yeah, man. They know not who they fuck with.
You can fuck with me. Dicks. You can fuck with Father Malone. Don't fuck with Heather. But
No.
Don't fuck with Mike White.
Don't fuck with any of us. Like, seriously, if you don't like it, you cannot listen to. You literally have free will to do this. Also,
yeah, but if you're religious, you don't have free will. It's all predestination.
Also, Mike likes to rumble, you know? Yeah.
Well, so do I, though.
Yeah, you both.
Is that a rumble?
Why not? I'm a kitty cat. And if you get me going, you'll see my claws.
Well, if you dress up like a kitty cat, I know somebody who'll play Twister with you.
It has to be a duck or nothing.
Earlier you said any animal.
You did.
Okay. Yes, but it would have to it would have to be like, you know, what's her name? The cat dancer.
The cat dancer
from Monkey Bone?
No, from Oh my God. Well, yeah.
Rose McGowan.
Sign me up right now. You know, yeah. Like
Rose McGowan.
And out of the cat costume with that lady.
Yeah.
It would have to be like the character came to life, or I got thrown into the Monkey Bone world. Yeah, there's a comic strip. I can't believe Omaha the Cat Dancer. Jesus Christ. Jessica would kill me.
Is this real? Is this a real thing you're talking
Omaha
about?
Omaha the Cat Dancer. Google it right now. It's a comic from the 70s, man. It's like this really sexy cat. Like, you know, yeah, I would have sex with that cartoon cat too.
I guess
we truly stepped into the darkest timeline here.
This is not dark. These are sexy cartoons.
Yeah. I'm a normal red-blooded American man, God damn it. Now give me them cat ladies.
Cat pussy is my jam.
Listen, everything I'm saying is totally normal.
Is what we're talking about any worse than going onto any of the porn websites and seeing it just inundated with stepson? Stepmother shit. Like, it's
why
no
are we going here? What are
I don't know.
What are you doing?
I'm proving a point. It's no different. Well, I was going to say at the end of every one of these,
it
episodes
is different because mine is never going to happen. It's not a possibility.
You like, don't know it, that.
Listen,
we live in exciting times. We live in unprecedented times.
Yeah, but nothing good. Like, you know, not
the duck fucking variety.
You know what I mean? Jessica Rabbit ain't gonna come to my house. You know?
That's true. But is she a human?
Yeah, she's not a rabbit lady.
She's a toon. She's strong.
Now that's different.
It's not different at all. This is what we're talking about. I'm saying any.
Oh, you would fuck a 2D character? How does that work?
I don't think that works.
I don't know, but I'm willing to find out.
You'd probably just get a paper cut on your dong, dude.
Yeah,
like, maybe you gotta involve.
That's a good name for a band.
Maybe
paper cut on my dong
for the tunes.
Dude.
Yeah. Yeah, paper cut on my dong. What a great
I can't believe
band
you
name.
Yelled at me about this.
Paper cut on my dong. So we always end these episodes the same way, which is what is the porn parody title for this film?
We actually Congo. Didn't do that with subs. We didn't do this with subspecies.
We did. It was cum species,
no,
blood thing.
No, we blood thing. Yeah.
We did do it.
Blood thing.
Blood thing.
Oh, Chris. My
Congo porn title is Hung O with hyphen.
And there's a duck lady in it mysteriously.
Sounds like the crossover cereal for fucking John Holmes. John Holmes is a hung.
Hung O's.
Oh my God.
Hi, I'm John Holmes. You'll never be me. But
he's got his he's using his dick as a fucking spoon to get those Cheerios out of a bowl.
What does Amy say? Oh, this is a cock too big.
Now we're in the darkest timeline. Okay, now we're the
John Holmes and animatronic Amy having sex with each other.
What was it? One of those Johnny Wad movies? It's like, oh no, Mr. Holmes, it's too big.
Yeah, yeah.
They went wrong.
What are you doing, Step Holmes?
Are you asking? I come up because cut instead of Congo, my first thought was one that is so obscene. I don't know if I should say it.
You should.
Are you guys sure? It's filthy. I want you both to always respect me.
I respect
you.
Worse than the bestiality we've been talking about for an hour and a half. Talking to go.
I'm not the one fantasizing about duck titties.
I'm open to the possibility.
You're like, I'm down.
I'm here. I'm ready for them.
Hey,
get used to it. Jesus.
This world just keeps on spinning. You know what I'm
no
saying?
Water off my back, baby. You know what I mean?
Okay. So the really filthy one, which I'm going to nix, but I'll say it, is cunt hole.
What?
Like
Congo, like Congo or Congo.
Cantal, okay.
Yeah, well, see, yeah. I told you.
I mean, that's pretty. Just like, yeah,
it's filthy. Yeah. I'm sorry. Do you still respect me?
Yes.
You guys saw the Malone. Do you still respect me?
No, I didn't respect you to begin with.
Oh, you motherfucker!
Cantal.
Well, I respect you, goddamn.
What's your other one?
That was your first mistake.
Cuckold. But that's
that
no,
one,
that's
that one over the first one.
Yeah. No, agreed. Because I instantly regretted when I thought of the first one. I shouldn't even mentioned it, and I'm embarrassed. But shame is for the weak, so fuck that. But think about it, because that's a very big trend in porn, I believe, is like being like, look at my hot wife, and she's going to get banged out, you know?
And it's like, look at my hot monkey. It's about to get banged out.
In this case.
Yeah. Dylan Walsh is like, I like watching my monkey get fucked.
Statue.
Oh, God. I think my soul just died.
What's mine? Mm-hmm. I wanted it to just be come go, but it doesn't. It just, it's not as good. Come go.
Come go.
I like it. Can we put an umlaut? Come go. Can we put an umlaut over one of the vowels?
Honestly, you know it's, what?
You know it what? Would That's be, the one to go with. That's the one that would be on the box, right?
It would like, be yeah. come go 69 exclamation point. Like airport 69, but like come go 69 exclamation point. Because no, there's got to be six. There's got to be six.
Come go in the font of Congo.
Right. But we'll but the reason it's come go 69 is because during the movie, you remember the scene where Ernie Hudson and the ape are flying through the air together? The ape would be reversed.
Right.
So there's
right,
the 69. Right. I get
that.
Part.
But don't direct the movie from the title. That scene That's will fair. Be in it That's and we'll fair. Enjoy it. It's not the focal
point enjoy of our We'll all premiere. Have a good time.
You know.
Ernie Hudson and the ape having sex in midair. Yep, we'll all have a great time.
Oh, don't
don't put that on me.
I love him. Like, no, we
devolved here.
I almost like should we? Like, should we cut out my first pick? I feel embarrassed now. Actually, feel like
why that is not the worst thing that's been said on this episode. This episode.
Yeah, that's what
Culture
I'm
Cast.
Saying. Like, what are you talking about? Like, this is pretty tame considering.
This episode of the Culture Cast has been brought to you by Bad Dreg. Unconventional dildos for unconventional people.